Yeah.
Shalom. Very nice to see you guys. Can everybody say Alhamdulillah?
Alhamdulillah.
Okay, we're recruiting again. It's good to be here in Southland. Wow, amazing. Nice digs you got here. Great to be with Ron and Tracy again. And in many ways, it is a homecoming. This is our homecoming. This is where I'm from. This is where you guys sent me. And, you know, if you're a church leadership, you're trying to figure out what to do with Artie Baker, you take the globe and you just spin it around to the other side and you say, that's where we're sending it. And so I bring you greetings from the other side of the world, the Middle East and Dubai. And 12 time zones away. That's a lot of flying. I'm a little bit jet lagged this morning, but it's good to be with you guys. But amazing to be home, to see the growth, to see how you guys have done. It has been amazing to come home. Thank you, Ron and Tracy, for having us. I love Ron. Ron, he thinks I was there for him, but he's always been there for me. And it's been amazing. You know, my name's RD, my beautiful wife, April. Thank you for praying for her. She's not doing well today. But it's amazing because I preached in 1995 here, my first time preaching in L.A.
Wow.
95.
I was born in here.
And it's interesting because April and I were talking, we discovered that we had both been at the same service.
Wow.
That's pretty coincidental, right? The interesting thing was that I was 30. And she was 9. Up front preaching about Father Abraham. She was in the back of Kids Kingdom singing about him. But how about Princeton and Joy George in the singles ministry right here? Now Princeton and I go back to our single days when we were both single. And I remember when he found Joy, he's like, I got the Joy, Joy, Joy George down in my heart. What a great name. But I will tell you, one of the keys to being successful in finding a wife is finding, like, what the key to success for me and April is that we're both in love with the same man.
Yeah.
That works every single time.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ. Oh. I was going to dress down today, but then I started looking around. I was like, okay, Ron Harding's there. Better wear this shirt and jacket. You know, and then I was like, when the Noel's there, I said, okay, I better wear a tie. But it's just good to be home. It's great to be home. You know, we went over 8 months ago, we planted the church in Dubai. We had our inaugural service September the 23rd. You can remember Deo Henderson, Anna Avilas. We had, of course, John and Janina Twasson went with us. And it's amazing what God can do with just a few people. We went over there to the Middle East and we said, we'll just get started. And, you know, you get over there with a lot of fire and spit and everything's going great. And then all of a sudden, it ain't going so great. Kit came over, did the inaugural service. We had 56 in our inaugural service.
Wow.
With it was like 11 of us.
Wow.
Not sharing our families. We were like, wow, okay, we're in the Middle East. And you know, it was great when Kit's there. You're kind of on the mountaintop, right, you know? And, you know, Mark and I, we're on the mountaintop, Jesus, transfiguration stuff. And then they come down in the valley below, Kip leaves, and it's like, bye! And it's like, oh my. And then the visa issues start coming. Then the job issues, people trying to find jobs. Where are we going to live? Speaking the language, trying to figure out where we're going to, you know. And then all of a sudden, it just got challenged.
Yeah.
And, you know, I ended up getting a job that was far more cumbersome than I thought it was going to be. I ended up working, wow, about 12 hours a day. Almost, one time, 20 days out of 21. And we just couldn't get any traction going. And then good old-fashioned sin started creeping in. You know, I was sharing with some sisters earlier, you know, when you're not growing and you're not outwardly focused, you start looking at each other and getting critical, right?
Yeah.
I don't like the way you said that to me. I don't know what she said. She know, you know? And good old-fashioned sin. We had some sin in the camp. We actually had to send a person home off the mission team. And came back for the winter workshop. And that was a big changing point for us at the winter workshop. You know, when you get your juices charged, and I'm so glad you guys were all there too. And encouragement, you get inspired. Consider yourself once you're rebuked, and then consider yourself forgiven, and then come back home.
Amen.
Came back, and Kip, right before we left, Kip said, hey, I'm going to come back with you. And for those who know Kip, it's like, oh, okay. And so, came back, And Kip just has a way of just sorting things out. Yeah. He just cuts right through the fog, you know. Yeah. Okay, we're going to deal with this. Amen. Started dealing with the sin. Started dealing with just getting us unstuck. Right. You know, the complacency. And he's such a solution-oriented guy. I love that. And we had our first baptism on New Year's Eve. A Pakistani guy named Noel, and he's definitely not the first Noel, so we call him the second Noel. But what a cool, a Pakistani guy whose name's Noel, which of course means God is born. And then we just get the train rolling, and all of a sudden we had another baptism, an Indian girl named Evangeline. Then we just, in two, became three, became four, became five, six, seven. Just baptized another married couple, Filipino couple. Amazing couple. Andrew and Mitch. And in 76 days, baptized 10 people.
Oh.
10. Plus we added about six more different people coming in, and your church of six is now almost, is 23, have almost quadrupled in 6 months. Real turning point was. The real turning point was when I got back from the Winter Workshop, and Kip said, because of the generous donations, because of the bucket shaking and the tagging and the car washes and the bake sales and the burrito sales and all the stuff, candied apples, and you know what you guys do. Because of the hearts of the saints right here in Southland, we're now going to bring you on full time in the ministry to focus just on building a church up. Anything else today that sticks with you, I want to say thank you from the bottom. From the bottom of my heart, because we just simply could not have done it. You know, God needs people to defend him, but God also needs, we need money. And it was just a huge turning point when I would see you guys out there tagging and doing the things you guys were doing and realizing that we really can't build a church if everybody's focused on secular work. And it has been amazing that now that I can come on and just focus on the church, and it has been incredible. We had 63 at a recent service. We had five different nationalities baptized. We just had our first African baptism. We had Filipinos. We got Indians, Pakistanis. We got Americans. We got a whole rainbow coalition going on. And it has been amazing. So from the bottom of my heart, I want to say thank you for all you've done for us. Turn your Bible to Acts 14, verse 19. You know, it's interesting living in the Middle East. You know, it's people think that Christianity is an American religion. It's not. It started right there in the Middle East. And it's kind of cool because it's a land where great men of the Bible were born and raised. And I was kind of going through a few this morning. There was like Zephaniah, Zechariah, Jeremiah, and Nehemiah, Hezekiah, Obadiah, Josiah, Isaiah. You know, we had a guy there recently, his name is Oscar Maya, and he got banished. He used a lot of bacon and hot dogs, but I mean, it literally changed my name now to Ardiah, and it's Abraliah, and, but it is the land that gave us the Messiah, amen? And so we're not planting Christianity in the Middle East, we're kind of bringing it on back, you know what I mean? But in Acts 14, verse 19, there's a small footnote here that could almost get forgotten if you read the Bible too fast. And let me encourage you, don't read it too fast. Yeah. Then some Jews came from Antioch and Iconium and won the crowd over. They stoned Paul and dragged him outside the city, thinking he was dead. Now, it's interesting because, again, you can kind of miss that. But Antioch and Iconium, that's in the Middle East. April and I were just in Turkey, where that's found, just a couple days ago. But it's in the Middle East where Paul looks up in the sky and probably utters this oft-repeated phrase, why me? Why am I the one lying in this harsh Middle Eastern sun that's just been stoned and left for dead by this angry mob? Why me? I think the Apostle Paul probably asked that question a lot.
Yeah.
Why me? Well, you know, why am I the one that's got to write all these harsh letters to the churches in Galatia and the church in Corinth? Why am I the one that's got to struggle with every stress and strain with false teachers, with false brothers, with false prophets? Why do I got to feel all this stuff? Why do I have to be the one to help save all these people? Why me?
Come on, Arjun. Come on.
And I thought about that. You know, I bet there were several people in the Bible. I bet Noah. had to look up into the heavens and say, why me?
Yeah.
Why have I got to build this ark in the middle of the desert? Moses, why me? Why do I have to lead 2 million seemingly ungrateful people out of the promised land?
Yeah.
Or out of Egypt into the promised land? Why do I have to face the most powerful leader in the world and say, let my people go? Why me?
Come on, bro.
I thought about this. Joshua, yeah. Gideon, yeah. Elijah. I was thinking about, how about David? Yeah. Why me? Why do I got to kill this giant? You know, why is my king trying to kill me? You know, why am I in this cave writing poetry? That's supposed to be fun. There's non-poets among the crowd. How about the Virgin Mary? Why me? Why do I got to be a pregnant teenager out of wedlock in Palestine in the first century giving birth to Messiah? How about John the Baptist? You know, why am I in this dungeon? Facing execution for literally speaking out against sin. Why am I going to be executed here? It's simply for obeying God. I think about the Apostle John. Why am I on this faraway island, exiled and banished, alone because I follow Jesus? And you think about Jesus. How many times could Jesus have said, why me?
Yeah.
In Gethsemane, why me? Why am I here? Why do I have to die to save these people? Why do I have to carry the cross? And I think really when you think about these lives, anyone who thinks that a life lived for God is a bed of roses, these lives are a call back to reality. Wow. Amen?
Amen?
Because it's not always a bed of roses. Have you personally ever wondered in your own walk with God, why me?
Yeah.
Why me?
Come on, bro.
Why do I have to forgive this brother? Sorry, how many times?
Right.
Why do I have to give 20-sometime special missions? Well, I got to do that.
Come on, bro.
Why do I have to go to midweek? You know, it's interesting because I believe the reason is Jesus summed it up in 4 words in John 15, 16. It says, because I have chosen you.
Yeah, come on.
Because I have chosen you.
Yeah.
You see, when God wants to change the world, he grabs a man and he grabs a woman first and changes them.
Yeah.
And then he changes the world. The whole world. And I think about that, how God interrupts lives.
Yeah.
Well, God comes and he just interrupts our lives. What were you doing on the way to you getting saved? I was doing this over here, doing my thing over here.
Yeah.
And God interrupts lives. It's like you look at Jesus' ministry, his whole life was just a series of interruptions.
Yeah.
And it's like God saying, if you just let me interrupt you, I might be able to use you. I might be able to do something with you.
Yeah.
Why me? Are you willing to be interrupted to impact a lost world for Jesus Christ? I think over and over and over again in Scripture, I see these two words forming on the lips of many. And I want to share really the lesson that I've learned from this. And my title of my lesson is simply, So You Want to Be a Missionary. So You Want to Be a Missionary. Look over a few pages into Acts 19. I want to share a few passages about God's Word. The original title of my lesson was Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. But I'll do that next time. Acts 19, I want to share really about one of the greatest missionaries that's ever lived, the Apostle Paul. In verse 11 of Acts 19, everybody there?
Yeah.
I don't want to put you guys to sleep now.
Yeah.
This is quite a beautiful building. I drove up and I'm like, I got the wrong building. Verse 11, God did extraordinary miracles through Paul. So that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick, and their illnesses were cured, and the evil spirits left them. Some Jews who went around driving out evil spirits tried to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who were demon-possessed. They would say, in the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches, that's exactly how he said it, by the way, I command you to come out. Seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this. One day, the evil spirit answered them, Jesus I know, and Paul I know about, but who are you? It's quite a funny passage here. Then the man who had the evil spirit jumped on them and overpowered them all. He gave them such a beating that they ran out of the house naked and bleeding. Now that's a beating. When this became known to the Jews and Greeks living in Ephesus, they were all seized with fear, and the name of the Lord Jesus was held in high honor. You think? You know, and I thought about this. He said, Jesus, I know. I know about Paul.
Come on, bro.
But who are you? Who are you? My first point is a critical one. It's don't try this on your own. Don't try this on your own.
Come on, RD.
You know, one of the things I love about being in the kingdom is that I'm not alone.
Wow. Yep.
I'm not in the Middle East alone. And think about it. Are you alone? I always worry when somebody says I'm alone.
Wow.
The fact that I've got a whole church family that's with me all over the world. The fact that I've got people that are praying for me, that are encouraging me, that are saying things on the Facebook. Remember the Facebook? I dabble around in that thing every once in a while, occasionally. But that makes me not feel alone. You know? Is that so when I'm in the world, it's I'm not alone. And remember, Jesus said, I'll be with you always to the very end of the age. So when people look at us and say, these guys have been with Jesus, no, Jesus is still with us.
Wow.
But I think this is a family thing. I'll talk about that a little bit in my sermon.
Come on, bro.
But the Christian life is not designed for you to try on your own.
Come on.
You know, I think about that. If you've been baptized into Jesus Christ, forgiven of all your sins, given this brand new life, then you've been empowered to live the life that God called you to live. God's power, though, doesn't enable you to live your life.
Come on.
And that's where we get trouble. God's power enables you to live the life that God has predestined you to live.
Yeah.
In other words, God's power is not there to help you serve your agenda.
Wow.
You know what I'm talking about, you know, because God already has an agenda in your life.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about? I say, hey, God, why don't you come over here and help me do my thing?
Wow.
No, God already has a thing for you.
Yeah.
And when you meet with God, he comes over and you help him do his thing.
Yeah.
And when you do God's thing, then God gets with you. It's pretty simple, huh?
Yeah.
So God enables us, he strengthens us to do things that we otherwise normally couldn't do.
Yeah.
Or we just do things and you step back and say, how did I do that?
Wow.
How did God do that with me?
Yeah.
What? Me? Are you kidding me? Do you know me?
Exactly.
Where you just step back and say, that had to be God. And then who gets the glory? Then God gets the glory.
Right, come on.
And I love that because you just step in. I don't know how you did that because underneath it all, I'm just afraid, scared to death, intimidated by the world type of person. It's just, and I'm bumbling and stumbling. And God says, I'm going to get with you. You've heard me say it before. It's kind of like where God takes his super and adds it to your natural and causes you to be supernatural. I think kind of where God takes his extra and adds it to your ordinary, and it causes you to be extraordinary.
Yeah.
All right, I got one more. Where God takes his awe and adds it to your son, and causes it to be
awesome.
Can't even drop this thing, whatever. But since I'm a preacher, I feel like I've got to warn you. Because here's the danger. If you ever start thinking it's you and not God, it's your strength and not God's strength, you are setting yourself up for the worst fall you'll ever face. Trust me, I've done it. I've been there. I've been where Aaron's at. We're just walked out. Just left. If you start thinking it's you and not God, you are setting yourself up for the worst thing ever.
Come on.
And I see it too often. Men and women trying to live the Christian life on their own strength.
Yeah.
And yet it can't be done.
Yeah, come on.
It cannot be done. Turn your Bibles to Galatians chapter 3.
Come on.
Come on, guys. We're going to get our money's worth today.
Come on.
So you want to be a missionary?
Come on, bro.
Well, good. I got some scriptures to get you ready.
All right,
Galatians chapter 3. I want to see, you know, the Bible's very subtle. Sometimes you have to read through the subtleties of the Bible. And sometimes it's subtle, so I want you to see if you can kind of just pick up the tone that Paul's getting at here. You know you get a tone?
Right.
Your mom would say, don't you take that tone with me.
Yeah.
My mom, I just got to spend a whole weekend with her. She's like, don't you look at me in that tone of voice. Let's see if you can pick up Paul's tone here, right? You foolish Galatians! You know that tone, right? Who has bewitched you? Are you so foolish? After beginning with the Spirit, are you now trying to attain your goal by human efforts? Here, sadly, in the first century, you got Christians trying to achieve their goals by what? Human effort. What does that mean? Without God, without the Spirit, and it simply can't be done. I was thinking about that. You know, one Bible account that's always terrified me is that of Samson. You know, the Old Testament. We read the Old Testament in this church, right?
Yeah.
Amen. We're a Bible church.
Yeah.
But back in Judges chapter 16, there's this account of Samson. Samson was this man once anointed by God, had all that hair. You know, speaking of hair, I come here this morning and I'm like, come on, I see some of y'all's hair is still faithful. Some of y'all's hair is still faithful.
Oh my God.
Now, some of your hair looks like it's falling away. Help us out, you know? I'm in my 50s. I can feel like I can say this stuff now. Sometimes your hair's falling away. But it's good to see a few of you. Your hair's been restored. That's been good, too. But Samson had this thing where he had all this hair, and he had this strength, and then he started thinking his strength was from his own doing. It was his strength. Eventually, he got into a situation where he thought he could do what he was always doing and be victorious.
Right.
But the Bible literally says Samson did not realize that the Lord had left him.
Yeah.
And thus taking away his strength.
Right. Come
and so
on.
This guy Samson, all that flowing hair, he did what he thought he could always do, but God stepped back a little bit, just for a moment, to let Samson see that it wasn't Samson doing it, but it was God doing it all along. Go back and read Judges 16, you'll see the result.
Yeah.
It wasn't Christ. Turn to 1 Samuel 15.
Come on, bro.
Another example was King Saul. You guys remember King Saul, right?
Yeah.
This guy once anointed by God, had all these great things going on in his life. God gave him strength. God anointed him. God made him king over all his people. But then King Saul started thinking it was all him. It's all me. He stopped needing God. He stopped relying on God. He stopped honoring God. And then he stopped obeying God.
Yeah.
Isn't that really always the pattern?
Yeah. Come on.
And the Bible says that Saul one day was going over and he was building a monument to himself.
Wow.
You always know when you're in trouble when you start building monuments to yourself. Amen?
Yeah.
No monument building to ourselves, right?
Yeah.
In verse 17, he gets this telegram from God. It says, this is 1 Samuel 15, verse 17.
Come on. Come on,
and here's the telegram. Although you were once small in your own eyes, did you not become the head of the tribes of Israel? The Lord anointed you king over Israel, and he sent you on a mission. Amen, missionaries? Why did you not obey the Lord? And it's interesting. It goes on to say that God grieved that he made Saul king. And then took the kingdom away. But worse than that, the Bible literally says in the next chapter that the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul. Does that terrify you?
Yeah, it does.
That the Spirit of the Lord, that God can pull his Spirit from you?
Yeah.
Yikes.
Look over a couple verses, a couple chapters, 1 Samuel 17. Look, ever since I was a little boy, I've always loved the story of David and Goliath. You guys know that one, right?
Yeah.
My first Bible was a pop-up Bible. Like one of the, whoa. I've always loved David and Goliath. It's always fascinated me. And I think because it deals with one thing that we deal with, fear.
Yeah.
You see, fear can grip us as Christians, right?
Yeah.
And to the point where it can control our lives. David's first battle that day was not with Goliath. His first battle that day was with fear.
Wow.
He had to overcome fear. And I want you to see how he overcame fear. And I love this. I love this. If you're ever going to preach or do a Bible talk, you always got to do 1 Samuel 15, verse 45. 1 Samuel 17, 45. You come at me against, you come against me with sword and spear and javelin. Well, I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day, the Lord will hand you over to me, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. Today, I will give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds of the air and the beasts of the earth, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. All those who gather here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands.
Wow.
How did David fight fear? He said, God's with me.
Yeah.
What you got?
Come on.
I got God with me. What you got?
Right.
Do you believe that?
Come on, bro.
I thought about that. I thought if I could go over and find the rock. Wouldn't it be cool if they could find the rock that killed Goliath? Some British museum somewhere, there's the rock. You know, get your little library card and get that rock. Wouldn't that be cool to just examine the rock? What do you think you'd find?
A rock.
Nothing exceptional about the rock. Well, okay, well, what if you could dig up David? Just dig up his bones. The Bible says he's there. Just dig up his bones and examine that hand. In that arm, that Randy Johnson thing, or maybe left hand. What do you think you'd find if you could dig up the hand of David? What do you think you'd discover? It's a hand. Just a bone. You'd find nothing exceptional about the rock. You'd find nothing exceptional about the hand. Well, what about the weapon? Oh, yeah, okay. The Bible says it was a slingshot. I played when I was about six. You know? I was still throwing rocks at my neighbor at 22, but still, it's a child's toy. So, this is what's always perplexed me about David and Goliath. If there was nothing exceptional about the rock, there was nothing exceptional about the hand that threw it, and there was nothing exceptional about the weapon, why did it have such an exceptional result? You see, here's the point. God got behind what David threw, and it made all the difference in his life.
Wow.
If God had not got behind what David slung, that rock would have bounced off of Goliath like a little peanut.
Come on.
He'd have ran over to David and beat him to a pulp. He'd be running naked and bleeding like these seven sons of Sceva right here.
Wow.
And I think about that. While we're waiting for exceptional equipment before getting into the fight, we end up missing our life. Because my Bible said that God's power is made perfect in our weaknesses. I'm sure I read that somewhere. Guys, let's just be my family here. Let's just pretend it's just me and you. The only way that you know that God is with you, it's when he takes substandard, ordinary, common equipment and performs supernatural feats. Where you're just left saying, Lord, I just don't see how you did that with me.
Yeah, come on.
You know who I am. You know me.
Yeah.
You did that with me. And then who gets the glory?
God
gets the glory. I mean, I love sharing the good news about what God's doing in the Middle East and what he's going to continue to do. And it's amazing because we got a harvest waiting for us. We got a sister. She's from Syria.
Wow.
She just finished the cross study. Her name is Aaliyah. Who's getting ready, prayerfully, to be your first Muslim baptism in the Middle East. Hindus are funny. I just let me go off topic a little bit. Because they have 21 gods. And when they study, they're like, oh, okay, Jesus will be number 22. No. You get rid of those other 21. Jesus is going to be the God, but you just never know what God's going to throw at you. Is God getting behind what you're doing?
Yeah.
Or are you trying to do it on your own strength? Jesus said twice in John chapter 5, twice, by myself, I can do nothing. By myself, I can do no thing. Now, Paul said it a little bit differently. He said, I can do all things through him who gives me strength. I love that. Listen to Paul's words here. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about the hardships we faced, the hardships we suffered. We were under great pressure. Any of you guys ever felt great pressure? Yeah, usually around the end of the month. You're like, oh, man. Great pressure.
Oh, my gosh.
Far beyond our ability to endure, so that we despair even of life. Have you ever despaired even of life?
Yep.
Woo! Indeed, in our hearts we felt the sentence of death. He was in a low spot here. And then he says, but here's what I figured out. These things happened so that we might not rely on ourselves.
Yeah.
Come on. But, there it is. Why? Because we want to rely on ourselves.
Come on, bro.
Paul said, God did all these things in my life so that I would not rely on myself. He says, so that we might not rely on ourselves. And he probably puts the pen down and said, that was a pretty good moment there. And then I guarantee you, something was nudging Paul. And he says, no.
Right.
Picks up the pen and says, so that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God.
Bars. Something like that.
Picks up the pen. Comma. Who raises the dead?
Come on, bro.
And he's like, God did these things. God did these things so that I don't rely on myself. Because that's my nature. I'll fix it. And when I'm fixed it, then I'll let Jesus in. I'll take care of this myself. And then when I'm finished, then I'll pray. Then I'll do it. No. God kept putting him in these hard situations. He wanted to die. Why? So that he wouldn't rely on himself. First, so that he would rely on God. And he says, oh, and if that weren't enough, he raises the dead. Let me ask you, what are you struggling with this morning? God raises the dead.
That's it.
But I got this husband of mine. God raises the dead. But I got this boss. You don't understand my boss. You don't understand my roommate. God raises the dead. I got this sin in my life. God raises the dead. I got these character issues. God raises the dead. God raises the dead. And it's right there. 2 Corinthians 1:8. Go back and highlight it.
Highlight it.
God is not going to let you succeed without him. He won't do it.
Damn.
Why would he? God did not create you to have you not need him. I have 3 grown daughters. I've never wanted to reach an age where they say, Dad, I no longer need you. They tried it. My oldest daughter, 15 years old, when she knew everything, I said, write your book now while you know everything. And she got out on her own. Oh, I know everything. I don't need Dad anymore. And all of a sudden, the car breaks down. Or some bill came in she didn't expect. Or something happens in life that she didn't, you know. God did not design you to not need him.
Wow.
Go ahead, bro.
When God gives you the Holy Spirit, he's given you something supernatural. He's given you a supernatural strength, and it is to be treasured.
That's it. Come on.
And I think David remembered what Saul was like before he had when God took his Holy Spirit from him. David looked at that situation, and he remembered what it was like for God to take his spirit from a man. He said, when he was caught in his own web of sin, remember that? He said, God, do not cast me from your presence and do not take your Holy Spirit from me.
Wow.
Remember that he prayed?
Yes, love that.
Acts 19.
Come on, bro.
When people start seeing you do things that are supernatural, and they see you doing things that you shouldn't be able to do, they start thinking, well, maybe I can do this too.
Wow. Uh-oh.
Maybe I can do this too. They start thinking, wow, if I had God's strength, what could I do with it? It makes things seem attainable.
Yep.
If that guy could be the preacher, woo-hoo, who knows, I could be a bishop. You know, you look at something like, wow. You know, I get up here, I see Aline singing. I see Calvin up here singing. I see these little ones. Shamira walked up to me and RD, I'm like, Shamira, like, man, what? I don't know what they're feeding her. Bernice, what you feeding her? She looks like, she's like a woman now. What's God going to do in your life? What's he going to do in your life? You see, the Apostle Paul made the power of God look so effective that people started thinking, oh, this is easy. And you go back and read Apostle Paul, you know, people get in his shadow and be healed. I mean, he had such power that he affected the atmosphere. He would just walk in a place, everyone around him, just being in a crowd. It's amazing. You know, he had such power that, the Bible says that handkerchiefs that touched him, they placed on their body to be healed. Don't you like that? I mean, putting it on their body, not only was he powerful, anything he touched was powerful.
Wow.
Wouldn't that be cool on campus?
Yeah, oh, yeah. Come on, bro.
Yeah. Around, I mean, just things, you know, people fall in their shadow and get healed. That was awesome. I love that. Here's the challenge. These seven sons of Sceva, who weren't even believing in Jesus, they were sons of a chief priest, they didn't even believe in Jesus Christ. They saw Paul casting out these demons, and they thought, we can do that. We can totally do this. And they kind of looked at him, you know. They were attracted to the Christian power and thought, let me just mimic it. Let's get the words down. What's he saying? Let's get his tone and everything down. And, you know, his movements, his language, his voice inflection, his words. Let's get it down. We'll drive these demons out and make some money. I love Hollywood. I love me some Hollywood. I went to Universal Studios last week. I love me some Hollywood.
Yeah, me too.
And it's interesting, so some of my favorite actors and actresses in history, there's these, they immerse themselves in these roles.
Right.
Yeah.
Maybe like Heath Ledger or Robert De Niro or Denzel. Just get so immersed in this role. They're being coached. They're taking notes. They're practicing their language. They're wearing the right clothes. They're using the right words and all the right lingo. Everything's right.
Yeah.
And I thought, but you can act like a pilot.
Right.
You can act like a boxer. You can act like a doctor.
Yeah.
But you cannot act like you got the Holy Spirit. You cannot act like you got the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit cannot be imitated. It cannot be duplicated. It cannot be bought. It cannot be faked. It cannot be harbored. You either got it or you don't. Are you with me? Here's my first question. If the seven sons of Sceva were here today, what would they tell you? The first thing is, don't try this on your own. Because there's a lot of people trying to live the Christian life on their own, and they're failing miserably. But you know, at the same time, and many in this room, there's a lot of people who are living the Christian life with God, and you're doing amazing. And maybe you don't even realize that it's God doing it through you.
Come on.
And keep doing what you're doing, amen?
Right.
My second point is victory is not as simple as it looks from the outside.
Mm. Come on.
You know, again, this is where these guys came up on the end, these seven sons of Sceva in Acts 19, these guys came up on the Apostle Paul at the end of his career. He was not that young guy just been baptized, kind of stumbling, fumbling, bumbling through life and trying to figure out how to have quiet times every day and, you know, work God into his schedule. No. Paul was nobody to be trifled with at 20 years old in the Lord.
Right.
You came up on Paul, if you were a demon, you were in for something.
Yeah.
Okay. You're going to get it. And I look at that, and I think, you know, because he was so powerful, it made it look so simple, people just thought they could do shortcuts.
Wow.
Oh, it didn't look that difficult. And you had people, these seven sons, in 20 minutes, were trying to attain what took Paul 20 years to attain.
Wow.
They were trying to take shortcuts. And I want to tell you, as a friend, there are no shortcuts to spiritual maturity. There's no shortcuts. There's no correspondence course. There's no Cliff's Notes. They still have those? There's no cutting to the end. It's a life of prayer.
Come on.
Of developing your prayer life. Of being open.
Yes.
Of not just reading the Bible, examining the scriptures. Not just sharing your faith, telling the people the full message of this new life. Not just throwing somebody an invitation. When you're sharing your faith, when you're sharing your life with somebody, that's when you can feel rejected.
Yes.
I just invited somebody to church. And they said no. I'm so persecuted.
Right.
I've been rejected. I just invited somebody to church. Get over it. Share with them the full message of this new life. Everybody in this room has a full message of what God did for you. They were trying to quickly obtain what took Paul years of blood, sweat, and tears to achieve. Number three. Seven men trying to do what one man was doing. Seven men trying and failing, I should add, to do what one spirit-filled man was doing, and it got the socks knocked off of him, literally. In other words, more numbers does not necessarily mean more power.
Right.
Ooh, more numbers doesn't mean more power. You know, I love that our church is still kind of small right now. I can't tell you how fired up I am to see John and Emma Causey joining our movement. And I know a lot of you love Luke. Don't worry, it's not about who we are, it's about whose we are, right? I preached in South Central. I was invited by John and Emma to come preach. There were 2,300 people in the Redondo Beach Performing Arts Center, and that just made up South Central. 2,300 people, and John and Emma were leading it. And they had doubled every ministry they had been in. They had doubled their ministry. And they had asked me, a missionary at the time, I was in the Middle East, and I'd flown back. This was, I think, 2002, maybe. And they had just baptized 109 people in 1 month.
Wow.
Still a kingdom record.
Yeah, it is.
And to hear them coming over here, they've now joined us. Guys, when people are watching, our skeptics, even our critics, even our enemies are watching on the sidelines. And when they see that it's real, these guys who were dogging Paul, they jumped into action. They said, okay, no, we're going to join that. We're going to be all part of that. I love that John and Emma are here. Right now, our church is small. And that means if you stay faithful, you're going to be a pioneer. You're going to be somebody's hero 10 years from now. You're going to do something just doing something for God, and God is going to use you to bring somebody in, and you're going to be their hero later.
Yeah, come on.
More power doesn't come from more people, and it never will. Ask Moses. Again, one man standing up against the most powerful army of his day.
Come on.
He was literally backed up against the Red Sea. And the other side, he had the Egyptian army coming at him. And I guarantee you felt alone. And what did God say? Just be still.
Amen.
And watch. Ain't it cool?
Amen.
I'll be with you. Well, who should I say sent me? Oh, you just tell him I am. Tell him I am sent you. That's enough. Joshua. The Bible says Joshua marched around Jericho, you know, walls came down. It was pretty amazing, huh? One guy tears down this whole fortified city. Gideon. I love the Gideon story.
Oh, yeah.
You know, literally 300 men against the Midianites. The Bible says we're thick as locusts. I love it. How can I save Israel? Gideon asked. The Lord answered, I'll be with you. Isn't that cool?
Yeah.
Elijah, 450 prophets of Baal, 400 prophets of Asherah, and one man. What one real man of God can do against 850 fakers. Ain't nothing like the real thing, baby. Ron's looking at me. I look at the apostles taking the gospel to the ends of the earth. 12 guys. Taking the gospel to the end of the earth. Jesus' 3 or 4 year ministry. The Bible says there's only 120 left. I look at all these over. God, look, surely the odds are against us.
Okay.
I'm living in a place where there's 5 million people in two closed cities, Abu Dhabi and Dubai. But that's only one of 18 countries. The odds are against us. There's always going to be opposition. There's always going to be persecution, real persecution waiting for you. But we have to be able to cry out, if God is with me, who can be against me? Do you feel that? Alright, very quickly, so you want to be a missionary, I'm going to give you some scriptures to get ready, alright? Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8, I'll read these out. That sounds cool to be a missionary, right? That sounds adventurous. It sounds pioneering. This sounds so cool, cutting edge, cool. I like it. Missionary. I'm going to be a missionary. And every sermon needs practical, so I'm going to give you some practicals. Isaiah 6, 8. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and whom shall go for us? And I said, here am I, send me.
Amen.
That's tattooish right there. That even tattoo on here. Isaiah 6:8, that's some cool stuff right there. Do you feel like God, here I am, send me?
Yeah.
Psalm 94:16.
Oh yeah.
Who will rise up for me against the wicked? Who will take a stand for me against evil? Can you say, I will, God? I'll defend you. Send me, I'll defend you. Because we're living in a world where God does need defending.
Yeah.
I'll defend you, God. In our increasingly troubled world, I'll defend you. And it ain't going to be on the internet that we're going to win people.
Right.
You know, I tried to do that. In Dubai, there's this new website, I've probably heard of it. We're going to try to get our message out there through Facebook.
Yeah.
And then that, you know, I was like, okay, it works a little bit. But then they had YouTube, and it worked a little bit. And then Twitter a little bit, you know. And then I found out that YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook formed a company together. One website called YouTwitface. And you can try to use that one, but it fell apart. Jeremiah 48, verse 10. A curse on anyone who is lax in doing the Lord's work.
Come on.
Come on, bro.
A curse on anyone who keeps their sword from bloodshed.
Woo!
A curse.
It's a curse, bro.
Are you lax in doing the Lord's work?
Yes.
What does the Bible say is your sword? It says that's your sword. Is it still in its sheath? Are you an ambassador for Christ hanging out at the embassy all the time? See, the thing is that, you know, we got to get our swords out. Evangeline is amazing. She's going to be a leader in God's kingdom. She's been a disciple only a few months now. She was our first female baptism. Evangeline, you know how she got met? Let me tell you our slick way we met her. Me and RJ Castro, who you sent to us, thank you. Hey, RJ's done a great job. Buddy.
Amen.
Thank you, LA. Me and RJ and April were sitting in a little cafe eating. We were talking about the church and some planning. We did a little planning session. And Evangeline walks over and says, hey, I just got here. She's from India, great gal. And I'm looking for the church. I said, well, you found it, honey. Right here. And April shared this last week in Orange County. How good that we, none of us, can take credit for Evangeline.
Yeah.
We just got our swords out. There it is.
That's it.
Guys, just get your sword out.
Yeah.
You know, I think Aleem and his crew got the record on YouTube. How many hits did you guys get on that? They were praying at a restaurant. Golden Corral, they were praying. Everybody heard about that.
Yep.
Get your sword out, amen? Jeremiah 12, verse 5, B. If you stumble in safe country, how will you manage in the thickets by the Jordan? Listen to that. If you stumble in safe country,
come on.
How are you going to manage in the thickets by the Jordan?
Yeah.
Literally, what's going on in that context, God's saying, you're struggling now? What's going to happen when it gets really tough?
Yeah.
Hello.
Guys, you're living in Los Angeles. I want to be a missionary. I want to go to exotic lands. And yet you won't even share your faith here?
Oh.
You won't even open your mouth and say, oh, these people, they're not open. Well, they're as open as your mouth.
Oh.
I'm having trouble having my daily quiet times with the Lord. I'm having trouble studying the Bible, reading, praying, examining, you know, blah, blah, blah. Not being in Bible studies consistently. Not being part of winning the world for Christ. If you stumble in safe country, how are you going to manage when it really gets tough?
Yeah.
No, bro.
1 Corinthians 16, verse 9.
Come on, man.
Paul says, a great door for effective work has been opened to me, and there are many who oppose me. Many who oppose me. There are forces of evil that are not pleased with what we're doing in the Middle East. There's forces of evil not pleased with what you're doing here.
Right.
Restorations and baptisms. And let me tell you, Satan's not happy.
Yeah.
Don't think for a moment that Satan is not going to fiercely oppose your plan.
Yeah.
And I don't mean just invite people to church. That's not what gets you persecuted. I'm talking about sharing your faith.
Come
amen?
On.
When God is opening a door for you, are you prepared to strongly oppose the one who's going to oppose you?
Wow.
Mark 3:31.
Come on, bro.
Couple more and I'll be done.
Come on, bro.
Who are my mother and my brothers? Jesus asked. Then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and my sister and my mother.
Yeah.
We are family.
Yeah.
We're not alone. And I love that. And I think, what kind of church is Ron and Tracy building here? Well, I've been on two big ships in my day, one right here in San Pedro. I got to go on the Elation.
Okay.
Anybody know the Elation? It's like a carnival cruise. It was like a... It's beautiful. And I've been on another big ship when I lived in Bahrain. That was the headquarters of the 5th Fleet U.S. Navy. I got to go on an aircraft carrier.
Nice.
The John F. Kennedy. It was amazing. Now, it's interesting because both of those have about 6,000 people in capacity.
Wow.
That's pretty low.
Right.
Now, on the aircraft carrier, and some of you who've served know, everybody on that aircraft has a role. In peace, in exercise, and in war. Every single person, from the captain all the way down to the cook, knows what I'm supposed to be doing at all times. What are you? I'm this. I'm petty officer. I do this. This is my role. I have this. I'm Yemen. I'm blah, blah, blah. Everybody knows what they're doing.
Yeah.
Now, cruise ship.
Oh, baby.
It's pretty cool. You have 6,000 people, and about 5,920 of them are laying on the lounge in the lounge chairs over by the pool. Eating lobster.
Ooh,
come on, bro.
Hanging around. They're just cruising. And you have about 80 workers running around doing all work.
Uh-oh.
Which ship are you on this morning?
David.
You're on a battleship, not a cruise ship. We're not building a church where you just sit back and let everybody else do the work.
Yeah.
We're building battleship that's prepared for battle. Do you know what your role is? We are family. And in my family, everybody got the blessings. But everybody had a chore. What's your chore? Acts 17, verse 6. These men who have turned the world upside down. This is our goal, the whole world. Amen. We're going to do it right here in South Central. South, right, all these little cities here that make up what we call Los Angeles. We're going to win this, but we're going to win the entire world, all the nations, the ends of the earth. We're not just a nice little local neighborhood church. And you guys got to be proud of that.
Amen.
Amen. John 4:35, do not say, there are still 4 more months and then the harvest. Open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe right now for the harvest. Amen. We got to stop procrastinating. We got to stop putting it off. We got to stop, I'll get to it later. I still believe God wants to use men and women in this room to change the world.
Yeah, come on.
But He's got to change you first.
Yeah.
To give up their lives, no matter what the consequences, no matter the hardships, and live out God's plan. I still believe God wants to interrupt lives and redirect them according to His purposes to seek and save the lost. You are a missionary. That's kind of my message, is you are a missionary. And you don't got to go to some country that you can't pronounce. It's speaking some language you can't speak, and you can't even spell. Kazakhstani, what? I don't know.
Come on.
You're a missionary.
Yeah.
Come on, bro.
If I took 100 people in a grocery store in Dubai and lined them up, how many do you think would be a true sold-out disciple of Jesus Christ? One? None? Two? What if you went out here and took 100 people at Vons? And lined them up. How many would be true sold-out disciples of Jesus Christ?
Right.
You see, the odds are kind of the same.
Yeah.
You are missionaries, guys. You are missionaries. Jesus, I know. I know about Paul. But who are you? You want another great story about God can use a man or a woman to accomplish something extraordinary? You be that man. You be that woman. You do it. You really want to see what a man of God or a woman of God can accomplish for God? Go try it.
Yeah.
You think you know how it ought to be done? Go do it. Take God up on His offer.
Yeah.
To use you, to give you His power, to make a difference in the lives around you. Why me? How about why not me? I'll end with this because I was thinking about this, what I really want in my life. I think we want to be useful to God. Amen?
Yeah. Amen.
We want to win as many as possible to the Lord.
Amen.
We want to be proud of our church.
Amen.
We want our lives to matter. We want to live righteously. And we want to have fun doing it. We want to be victorious. We want to finish the race.
Yeah.
We want to make it all the way home to heaven to be with the Lord. But whatever you do to serve and honor God in your own way, don't try this on your own.
Yeah.
Amen.
Come on.